Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to call the meeting to order. Please stand for a pledge to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
For the record, this is a public meeting of the Bayonne Board of Education. It is 8 p.m., the 26th day of April. We're convening in the Alexander O'Connor Auditorium. The presiding officer is Joseph Broderick, president of the Bayonne Board of Education. Those in attendance include Dr. Patricia L. McGeehan, superintendent of schools, Mr. Kenneth Kopasz, assistant superintendent for personnel, Dr. Gary Maeda, board secretary, Mr. Leo J. Smith, Jr., assistant superintendent for business, Dr. Dennis Degnan, assistant superintendent for curriculum and instruction, and Mr. Mitchell Pasquale, our Esquire, our board counsel. The meeting is open to the public. I will take a roll call. Trustee Cruden?
Here.
Trustee Desmond?
Here.
Trustee Finnerty?
Here.
Trustee Gerlich?
Present.
Trustee Lawande?
Here.
Trustee Munoz?
Here.
Trustee Ryan?
Here.
Vice President Wilbeck?
Here.
President Broderick?
Here.
Mr. President?
For the record, adequate written advance notice of at least 48 hours given the time, date, and location of this meeting with the agenda was provided as follows. Notice was prominently posted in City Hall at 630 Avenue C on the bulletin board reserved for such announcements of the Board of Education. The board secretary sent such notice to the Jersey Journal and the Bayonne Community News. Notice was filed with the municipal clerk of the City of Bayonne, Mr. Robert F. Sloan.
Okay, this evening we will start with our consent agenda. The only change to our consent agenda is resolution number 36 is being tabled for this evening. So we will first start with our consent agenda. I'll take a motion and a second first.
I'll motion.
And our second.
I'll second.
But I do have some questions from the audience on resolutions with the consent agenda. I'm going to remind the members of the audience, we take our questions by card. You are allowed 3 minutes. When you get to about 2 minutes, I will kind of raise my hand to get your attention, and unfortunately, I will cut you off at 3 minutes. So first up, on resolution number 34, the school calendars, Dr. Andrea Resitar, 22 West 41st Street.
When I attended the 6 o'clock workshop, there was a discussion about the number of students that were absent on Holy Thursday, and maybe we should, you know, add Holy Thursday to the list of vacation days. My question is, why are we just not having off the whole week before Easter and taking off Bright Monday? This year, that would have made a world of difference. We had a number of students taking off for Passover and Holy Thursday. I don't think we had that many mixed marriages in Bayonne, but apparently students are investigating a lot of religions. So if we had done that for this school year, we would have alleviated that problem. I mean, I didn't look at the calendar to see if, you know, after Bright Monday there was another holiday. But I think that would have been a more prudent thing to do for this current school year. I think we would have had more bang for our buck instruction-wise. And I don't know if you have room to do that for the next school year's calendar, because Easter is a little bit earlier, and I don't know if you want your spring break that early. But I think that would help alleviate some of the problem with the extra days. You're not having any more days off that way. It's still 6 school days off. It's just the week before Easter and Bright Monday. So that's just a suggestion that I have. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rustin. Okay, so we have a motion and a second on our consent agenda.
Dr. Maeda?
Yes?
Can we take the calendar off the consent agenda and relook at it and do it for May 8th? Mr. Kopasz and Dr.
Is that doable, Dayman? Mr. Kopasz?
Yeah.
Take it out, table it, we'll do it May 8th?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
What number was it? 34? 34? Okay. We'll get to
34.
So we're tabling number 34 and number 36. So I have a motion and a second on the consent agenda. Trustee Cruden?
Yes.
Trustee Desmond?
Yes.
Trustee Finnerty?
Yes.
Trustee Garrelick?
Aye.
Trustee Lawande?
Yes.
Trustee Munoz?
Yes.
Trustee Ryan?
Yes.
Vice President Wilbeck?
Yes.
President Braga?
Yes.
Okay, that brings us to Resolution 42. Whereas a lawsuit has been instituted, instituted in the Superior Court of New Jersey, Law Division, Hudson County. It's AH versus the Bayonne Board of Education. It's been determined in the best interest of the Bayonne Board of Education to settle any and all claims. It's a total of $375,000. It shall be paid by the New Jersey School Insurance Group and Summit Risk. Our resolutions are up on the bulletin board if you would like to read the complete version of the resolution. Do I have a motion?
A motion.
And a second?
I'll second.
On that motion and second, Trustee Cruden?
Yes.
Trustee Desmond?
Yes.
Trustee Finnerty?
Yes.
Trustee Garrelick?
Aye.
Trustee Lawande?
Yes.
Trustee Munoz?
Yes.
Trustee Ryan?
Yes.
Vice President Wilbeck?
Yes.
President Broderick?
Yes.
Resolution 43. No, that was part of the consent agenda.
That was part of the consent agenda.
Okay. But actually, let me finish this first. 43 is also an authorization for a settlement. There was a claim against the board, and it is a settlement of $10,000. And we have a fully executed release and stipulation of dismissal. Once again, this is to be forwarded to the New Jersey School Boards Association. This is Resolution 43. It is on our website. I'm sorry, on our bulletin board. And it will be on our website. Do I have a motion?
I'll motion.
And a second?
I'll second.
On that motion and second, Trustee Cruden?
Yes.
Trustee Desmond?
Yes.
Trustee Finnerty?
Yes.
Trustee Garrelick?
Aye.
Trustee Lawande?
Yes.
Trustee Munoz?
Yes.
Trustee Ryan?
Yes.
Vice President Wilbeck?
Yes.
President Broderick?
Yes.
Trustee, just reminding me, on our last item on our consent agenda was a Resolution 41, which is a resolution stating that the board, and this is on our website currently, our board has to have a special meeting on the public budget. It's our special public budget meeting. It will be Monday, May 8th. There will be an open workshop at 6 p.m. in the Anna J. Herbert meeting room, and then we will follow it with a public meeting out here in the auditorium. Okay. Thank you for reminding me of that. Next up is 44, whereas based on the enrollment of students in various grade levels education programs throughout the district, it is necessary that the following staff be reassigned within the school district or newly appointed personnel be assigned to the following positions for the 2016-17 school year. Be it resolved that based upon the recommendations of the Superintendent of Schools, Dr. Patricia L. McGeehan, the assignments, reassignments are hereby made for the 2016-17 school year. Effective May 1st, 2017, all assignments, reassignments are made without change in salary unless otherwise indicated. Tom Jacobson, Director of Nurses, Health, Vocational, Community, and Physical Ed, to Director of Health, Athletics, Community, and Physical Education. Kara Degnan, Director of Science, to Director of Science, Nurses. Daniel Ward, Director of Social Studies, to Director of Social Studies, Vocational, Library, and Media Services. Lisa Wasluski, Assistant Principal, Washington Community School, Assistant Principal, Woodrow Wilson Community School. And Alana Ryan, Assistant Principal, Lincoln, Mary J. Donahue, and Vroom Community School, to Assistant Principal, John M. Bailey Community School. Do I have a motion?
I move.
And a second.
I'll second that motion.
On that motion and second, Trustee Cruden?
Yes.
Trustee Desmond?
No.
Trustee Finerty?
Yes.
Trustee Gerlich?
Aye.
Trustee Lawande?
No.
Trustee Munoz?
No.
Trustee Ryan?
Abstain.
I has to abstain, that's correct. Vice President Wilbeck?
Yes.
President Broderick?
Yes.
Okay, resolution passes. 45, whereas the Bayonne Board of Education is desirous of utilizing funds allocated under the ESEA No Child Left Behind Consolidated Formula Subgrant Application Title 2A Program for the 2016-17 school year to advance teaching and learning. Whereas the Superintendent of Schools, Dr. Patricia L. McGeehan, has recommended the following personnel be reassigned to the FY 2017 ESEA No Child Left Behind Consolidated Subgrant Application Title 2A Program. From April 1st, 2017 to June 30th, 2017. Therefore, be it resolved, the following personnel be reassigned. The FY 2016-17 year for the application, Title 2A, Dr. Eliana Desjardins, Director of Planning, Research, Evaluation, Assessment, and Accountability, 2 Data Analysis Coordinator. Her salary is being adjusted and paid out of the Title 2A funds. Do I have a all these are on our bulletin board. Motion?
I'll motion.
And a second?
I second.
On that motion and second, Trustee Cruden?
Yes.
Trustee Desmond?
Yes.
Trustee Finerty?
Yes.
Trustee Gerlich?
Aye.
Trustee Lawande?
No.
Trustee Munoz?
Yes.
Trustee Ryan?
Yes.
Vice President Wilbeck?
Yes.
And President Broderick?
Yes.
46, whereas pursuant to NJAC 6A:23A-3.1 and its contract with the Superintendent of Schools, the Bayonne Board of Education established quantitative and qualitative criteria and associated merit bonuses for the superintendent for the 2016-17 school year. Whereas the Board of Education has now reviewed indicators of achievement of those goals, it is hereby resolved this 26th day of April 2017 that the Bayonne Board of Education accepts the merit goals as established and hereby submitted to the Executive County Superintendent of Schools for approval as required by law per NJAC 6A:23A-3.1. Do I have a motion?
I'll motion.
And a second?
I will second it.
Mr. D'Angelo?
If these goals go through the county and they're accepted, what's the amount of the merit goal? Financial compensation?
$26,607.
So she would get, the superintendent would get that?
She'd get a percentage for each goal based on her total salary of $177,500. I believe it's 14.9% times the 177.5 for the goals.
Thank you.
Okay, we have a motion and a second on that. Trustee Cruden?
Yes.
Trustee Desmond?
No.
Trustee Finerty?
No.
Trustee Gerlich?
Aye.
Trustee Lawande?
No.
Trustee Munoz?
No.
Trustee Ryan?
Yes.
I'm sorry, Trustee Ryan?
Yes.
Vice President Wilbeck?
No.
And President? President Broderick?
Yes.
It does not pass. Resolution 47 was tabled for this evening. That'll take us to Resolution 48, whereas vacancies exist for over 60 days in certain disciplines in the Bayonne Public School District, whereas these vacancies have been filled by the same substitute for 60 days, whereas per statute NJSA 18A:16-1.1, a substitute possessing a certificate of eligibility and is substituting in the same position for more than 60 school days must be compensated on a prorated basis beginning the 61st school day based upon the following annualized rates for the duration of the assignment. Now, therefore, be it resolved, the below-named substitutes will be compensated on a prorated basis for the duration of their current assignment based upon the salaries adjacent to their names and on the effective dates indicated. Ralph Massone, Joe Mingoya, Mark Mulholland, all at $5,318 per month, and all April 16th, 2017. Do I have a motion?
I'll make that motion.
And a second?
Second.
And a second on that motion and second, Trustee Cruden?
Yes.
Trustee Desmond?
Yes.
Trustee Finnerty?
Yes.
Trustee Garrett?
Aye.
Trustee LaWanda?
Yes.
Trustee Munoz?
Yes.
Trustee Ryan?
Yes.
Vice President Wilbeck?
Yes.
President Broderick?
Yes.
Okay, Resolution 49, and once again, these are all on our bulletin board. Whereas the Bayonne Board of Education is authorized to reduce the number of non-certificated employees employed in the school district for reasons of economy. Whereas for reasons of economy, excuse me one second, please. Whereas for reasons of economy, the board finds it advisable to reduce the number of non-certificated staff members through reduction in force. Therefore, be it resolved by the Bayonne Board of Education as follows. The following positions are hereby eliminated as a result of reduction in force. 15 secretaries, 1 attendance officer, 8 engineer custodians, 2 bus drivers. That due to the above described reduction in force, the contract of the following non-certificated staff members be terminated effective June 30th, 2017. That the effective employees will promptly be provided appropriate notification of their employment status, and that the superintendent or her designee is authorized to provide the necessary notification of the affected employees. This is Resolution 49 on that front bulletin board. Do I have a motion?
I'll make that motion.
And I know, either hold on. A motion?
Second.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay, now I have a card in regards to certain resolutions. I know it's 49 and 50, but okay, Miss, well, okay. So then Miss Cheryl Jablonski's coming up, 131 West 52nd Street. I'll give you 3 minutes on 49, and I know you'll make general comments for the other.
No. I think I'm going to address 49, 50, and 51 because in my heart, they're all the same. For 6 years, I've been coming to many of these Board of Ed meetings, and I've been watching central administration tell the trustees that their proposals were going to cost little to no money. No matter what they dreamed up, it always seemed as if it were not going to cost the Board of Education anything. New academies. Oh, it's not going to cost much. We're going to do the work in-house. No extra funding needed. I didn't believe it. Most people that heard it didn't believe it. But it was stated at meetings. Dinners for accepted students. Oh, don't worry about that. It was paid for by Solar Rex. Our scrap metal paid for it. These are the things that have been put on record by our central administration at Board of Education meetings for years. We have all been lied to. And tonight we're going to put the lives of potentially hundreds of people, good people, that haven't lied. They haven't lied to taxpayers. They haven't lied to trustees. But they are going to lose their jobs tonight. And it just breaks my heart. Along with that, we started summer school, no charge. How do we pay for this? AP exams, no charge to the students. Even if you take the AP class and it's a joke because you have senioritis, we're going to pay the fee. Zero period. We have zero period. Do you know how much that costs? Has anybody done an analysis of that? All of these extra programs we could be looking at. Is it really needed that students have to take phys ed zero period? Can they take it during their regular 8-period day? Athletics. The athletic budget has gone up and up. I have not heard one discussion of that budget being chopped. Somehow, I believe people whose jobs are on the line tonight would be happier to see a small side job being cut as opposed to their livelihood. Is this any of this even being considered? I cannot understand why there are no resolutions before we get to numbers 48, 49, 50, and 51 that are dealing with the root cause of this problem. Central administration has to be held accountable. And with that, I would like to close. When will central administration be held accountable for this mess? That's my question.
You're going to answer.
Mr. Boz, yes. How are you tonight? I'm sorry that you're up here with the sadness.
My heart is bleeding, Mr. Broderick.
Hi. Can you hear me? Okay, thank you. Regarding the situation, okay, you're basically correct. Problems have happened. It's probably been happening, and I can say conservatively, for 10 years. You know, we can go back 10 years to where this started, the snowball came, and now it's coming down the hill at us. I would say a couple of things. One is that there's nobody up here that looks forward to what we're doing tonight. This is just a horrible night. I've had many bad nights at the board. This is by far the worst. But why we're doing it, say the way we're doing it, is that we realize what a gigantic decision this is, how many lives we're truly affecting tonight, and it's not a pleasant thought. But what we want to do, and the reason it's being done and sort of in the way it's being done, is because of we want to have a couple of reasons. One is absolute fairness to everybody that's in that situation. We don't want to rush in. There shouldn't be a targeted group and say, well, this is it. I think this has to be done over a period of time to really take a good look at who needs to come back, how many can we bring back. We're still in a situation where our budget hasn't been approved. It was approved, then it's unapproved. So we're still working without an approved budget. So all these things do matter. Going back to your question about us, who's responsible? Well, at the present time, there's an audit going on in the building. Hopefully that'll be the answer to that. I know it's not the quick answer everyone would like to see or anything like that, but it is an answer. And finally, I'd like to just say that regarding the people, since I know a lot of things have been said about, you know, the elected board, they're not doing this, they're not doing that, they're not, but I ask you this, and I know you're an honest person and you'll tell me. Since the elected board came on, do you know of anything that was really done that you would call an expense? So, I mean, the only expense that I can really say we voted on that was a major expense was the contract, and certainly rightfully so. Now, I'm only talking about within the last year and a half, let's say. So what we're doing now is us, like everyone else, are faced with a situation that's just horrible, and we're faced with the realization that we have to start correcting it. Now, is it going to be painless? Absolutely not. It's going to be very painful. But I'm just trying to give you an answer as to where
we're at. Am I allowed to respond?
Sure.
Okay. I certainly understand that this has long been a culture, long before most of the trustees seated up there, if not all of you, were around. I fully understand that, and I certainly hope that the taxpayers understand that this culture and this precedent has long been set. And I, going back to since prior, right before the elected board was seated, right after you were elected, but prior to your being seated, I believe that was the very large purchase of smart boards in this district. That had nothing to do with the elected board. It was done right underneath, right before you were seated, if my memory serves me correctly. However, since you did ask, the other expenditure that I do recall was the additional administration that was added on this past summer, which I believe most of it has been undone.
This summer?
Not this summer when new administrators were added?
No.
No? 2 summers ago?
We hired no administrators.
So that was done 2 summers ago.
Since I'm on this board, we've hired no administrators.
So 2 summers ago, so that was not...
In fact, we reduced it by at least 9 or 10.
Right. Oh, I'm sorry. That was when tenure was being voted upon that night.
Okay.
When they're... Right, that was the night.
All right.
Okay. So that's...
All right.
But no,
I just want you to know we feel your pain. Everyone's pain.
You're the seated trustees. I understand that a lot of this problem was done. You inherited this problem, unfortunately, and I hope taxpayers get it. But my problem with this is all of the employees are being hit, except for the ones that are the cause of the problem.
All right, so we have a motion and a second on 49. Trustee Cruden?
Yes.
Trustee Desmond?
No.
We don't have a card, so the board tell me what you want me to do. On resolution 49? Then I apologize.
I'll down, Mr. Woods.
Go back. Start walking down, Mr. Woods. I'll find it.
It has to do...
I'll give it to you. I know it wasn't maybe...
Okay. Gene Woods, 18 Zabriskie Avenue, Bayonne, New Jersey. So, it's kind of two-parted here. The first one has to do, obviously, with those who will be let go. And it has to also do with those who will continue to be here. We were promised July that we would receive our retro. My concern now is, how will this, the... disapproving of the budget and the other things that have been going on, how will that impact many of us? Because those who are leaving, they might have a real difficult time finding a job. And the little amount of retro that they get, will they get that? Will we receive that? Since this is all happening right now.
I'll try to answer that, and then I'll let our finance people do it. But we were assured that the budget that, what happened was the budget sort of was approved, then unapproved, and they're looking at different items on it. But the money for the retro is a line item, and it's there. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, did you answer yes? Yes, you will teachers will receive their retro.
Yes.
Unless something catastrophic happens that I don't know about, but that's certainly one of the line items.
See, that's the thing that I'm worried about. You said something catastrophic. Several catastrophic things have happened, and this is why we have the room filled here right now with tons of people. So that's my concern now, because some of those people who will be leaving might need some of that money to hold themselves together until they can actually find a job somewhere else.
Well, I can only tell you, as of this moment, yes, it is. And it is a line item, and it is going to be done.
Okay.
Anything else?
No, that's it. Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Mr. Woods? Just as a point of information, on the question, the very exact question that you asked Mr. Broderick, we trustees asked our accountant as well as Mr. Smith, because it is foremost in our minds that a promise made is a promise fulfilled. And that's what we're trying to do.
Okay. Thank you.
No, Mr. Woods.
Sorry.
It's okay.
I don't think you could find five trustees up here that would vote against the teacher's retro, regardless of the financial situation. So the teachers are getting their retro, as far as we're concerned. That's it. All right? You won't be able to find five trustees to vote against that. In other words, if a resolution is put before this Board of Education and the trustees to withhold the teacher's retro, it's no. That's it. Okay. They will be getting their retro.
Can I clarify? Yes.
Go ahead.
Okay.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you,
Mr. Woods. Okay, so 49. I have a motion and a second. Trustee Cruden?
Yes.
Trustee Desmond?
No.
That's a no. Trustee Finnerty?
Yes.
That's a yes. Trustee Garlick?
No.
Trustee Lawande?
No.
Trustee Munoz?
No.
Trustee Ryan?
Yes.
Vice President Wilbeck?
Yes.
President Broderick?
Yes.
Resolution passes. Number 50. Whereas the Bayonne Board of Education is authorized to reduce the number of non-certificated employees employed in the district for reasons of economy, where the reason for economy, the board finds it advisable to eliminate the position of copy room supervisor through reduction in force. Therefore, be it resolved that the Bayonne Board of Education, as follows, that the following position be eliminated as a result of reduction of force: the supervisor of the processing center, that the affected employee will promptly be provided appropriate notification of her employment status, that the superintendent or her designee is authorized to provide the necessary notification to the affected employee. Do I have a motion?
I'll make that motion.
And a second?
Second.
On that motion and second, Trustee Cruden?
Yes.
Trustee Desmond?
No.
Trustee Finnerty?
Yes.
Trustee Garlick?
Yes.
Trustee Lawande?
Yes.
Trustee Munoz?
No.
Trustee Ryan?
Yes.
Vice President Wilbeck?
Yes.
President Broderick?
Yes.
Resolution 51. And then Dr. Resitar, you'll be up for, you have a card for Resolution 51 after I read it. Whereas the Bayonne Board of Education is authorized to reduce the number of teaching staff members employed in the district whenever, in the judgment of the board, it is advisable to abolish any such positions for reason of economy or for other good cause, pursuant to NJSA 18A:28-9. Whereas, for reasons of economy, the board finds it advisable to reduce the number of teaching staff members through reduction in force. Therefore, be it resolved that by the Bayonne Board of Education as follows, that the following positions are hereby eliminated as a result of reduction in force: 261 teaching positions. That due to the above described reduction in force, the contracts of the following non-tenured teaching staff be terminated pursuant to the terms of his or her respective employment contracts effective June 30th, 2017, that the affected employees will promptly be provided appropriate notification of their employment status, and that the superintendent or her designee is authorized to provide the necessary notification to the affected employees. There are a few pages. Everything is on that front bulletin board with all the names. Do I have a motion?
I'll make that motion.
And a second?
I'll second.
I have a card. Dr. Resitar, 22 West 41st Street, would like to speak on Resolution 51.
I think it's a travesty to see what I believe is every non-tenured teacher in the district being scheduled to receive a reduction in force letter. I would have hoped that since the budget deficit was first identified back in November of 2016 and possibly earlier, that the board would have had adequate time to discern exactly how many staff members would actually need to be dismissed to make ends meet. This resolution creates a tremendous amount of anxiety throughout the staff, whether it's teaching staff or non-teaching staff. Everyone, you know, energy is better spent teaching students will now be directed towards looking for more stable employment. I find it troubling that Central Office has congratulated themselves for years for being able to do so much with so little, and now it's very clear that they had champagne tastes on a beer budget. And now many innocent people are suffering. I sincerely doubt you can run this district and provide a thorough and efficient education with this number of cuts to the teaching staff. You run the risk of having highly qualified people that have been trained in the Bayonne School District with 3 and 4 years of teaching experience going off to other school districts and getting hired. And what are you going to be left with? Historically, it's been very difficult for you to hire math and science teachers in particular. I said, and so now when our math and science teachers that are non-tenured go off and get jobs elsewhere, what are we going to do in, you know, August 31st when school is starting and we still don't have a math teacher for a classroom, or we still don't have a physics teacher for a classroom? So I really think time should have been spent. You know, it's not nice for anybody to be laid off, but to have 261 people laid off in key teaching areas that you have historically had difficulty finding qualified people for, I just think it's foolishness. I'm sorry.
Guy. If I can make a quick response to Dr. Resitar, part of the problem was that there was a group. There were names associated. There were positions associated. But many of the board members and others felt that it's too big a decision to leave to a few. We wanted to take, I think we want to exhaust every opportunity for everybody to have the same opportunity to be brought back. Saying that, I know the number sounds extremely large, but over two-thirds of the people that are being mentioned tonight will be invited back and as soon as at all possible. We can't, unfortunately, we still don't have a budget. There's still matters we have to work out, and there's still areas we have to deal with. But as quickly as we can do these things, we intend to do it. But like I said before, we certainly don't want to make a decision that we would come back to regret later on. So I know it's not a great answer that you'd want to hear, and I'd like to say yes, we're bringing back every person, but the fact of the matter is we're not going to bring back every person. But we will look as quickly as possible. We will make decisions as quickly as possible, and that's hopefully in the near future. Thank you.
Mr. D'Angelo. For this item, no.
Mr. Broderick, I didn't understand what you just said, but I don't want to hear it again. The problem was, and Dr. Resitar alluded to it, this budget problem started the last week in November, as I recall, maybe the first week in December. It's been 5 months. Are you telling me that after 5 months, the 9 people that are supposed to run this Board of Education couldn't narrow down to 261 people? Are you kidding? I'd like an answer to that.
The answer is we're not the ones who pick the people. Central office, the experts that work here every day.
There aren't any experts up there.
The people that are here on a daily basis are the people that are going to make those decisions. Now, many of us don't think that that decision should be made that quickly or that simply.
5 months.
Well, in 5 months, haven't people been let go? Haven't been changes made? We can't make things. I'd like to make things as quickly as you'd like to, but sometimes that's an impossibility. And wanting to do it right rather than quick, I think, is more important. Now, I know that's not a great answer, but that's the only thing I can tell you that we're trying to do.
I think it's ridiculous that you let the 261 go. The initial, what I was
well, like
told...
Like I said, we're not letting them go. We're letting them go, but hopefully we'll bring them back in the very near future.
For the 261 people sitting here and the ones that didn't come, they're let go when they get that letter. They don't understand what you just said. Because common sense would say, if you were going to bring two-thirds back or 180 so, you wouldn't let them go in the first place. It's not that hard to figure out what you have to do. When you talk to the directors of each department, you first have to just look at who's non-tenured. And you have to decide from there. But there has to be, in 5 months, you have to have a plan. If you don't have a plan after 5 months, what makes us think you're going to have a plan in 2 more months or 3 more months when you have to start hiring back? So you know what? Because I think that's a ridiculous. This is what was done years ago in this district. When the end of the year came, they let go all non-tenured. And the board at that time learned a very good lesson. The people that could get another job somewhere else left. They never came back. And they're much better off in another district. And that's what's going to happen this time. So you'll be short certain people in certain disciplines because you didn't take the 5 months and do the right thing. You are the people, as I reminded you once before, that run this system. When you say it's up to the directors, they're only giving you a list of people that you have to choose from and see how you can reduce, if you're going to reduce at all. So it should have been able to be done much sooner than 5 months, but you chose to do this to everybody. So there'll be sleepless nights. They won't know if they'll be able to pay their bills. More importantly, they won't have medical insurance after the summer. I don't think anybody would argue what it is to how bad it is to go without medical insurance. And that's what you're doing. So, you know, I can't stop you from passing this resolution unless five of you decide against it. But I will tell you what I will do. I will be meeting with...
Can I ask you a quick question, though? If we don't pass it, what's our option?
You should have come back with a concise...
I mean, I could have said last month, all right, let's get rid of this 60.
Right?
Let's say we did that.
Right.
That's still those 60 people.
Then 200...
You wouldn't rather have this on a fairer basis?
How is that fair?
Well, if you want to... Who do you want to look at and make your decision for you? People came up and said, well, the people here right now, they're causing this problem. Well, those same causing the problem people are going to be the ones that picked those people. If we wait, possibly it's a larger group that takes a look, looks at it more in a more honest, let's say, fashion, and say, where do we really have to go, and try to fix it in the right way. I know quickness it would be great, but we don't have quickness. We have to do it the right way.
I don't consider 5 months being quick.
And as I said before, during those 5 months, things were being done on basically on a monthly basis, which people came up and said how wrong we were for doing it at that time. I remember you coming up and saying we never should have let those people go.
You're right. Well, and I don't think you should let any of these people go.
But you're not giving any answers.
Mr. Clark, would like to speak.
What?
Mr. Clark, may have an answer.
Can I just try to answer some of the issues you raised? Unfortunately, we didn't have 5 months because the process is that we go through the effort of trying to identify the problem, and then we submit a budget. And we actually submitted our budget early, hoping to get an answer back as soon as possible, because during that period of time, a number of different options have been worked on as to what we would need to do to address the issue. But besides the expense side and the deficit side, there's a question about the revenue. and the revenue issue won't be decided until we get a budget back. And that's why we were hoping we could get it as soon as possible. That's why we've conferred with the state of New Jersey, looking to do some creative things to minimize the impact on staff, and we still don't have answers on that. And in fact, tomorrow we were supposed to have a meeting with the Commissioner of Education to go over this. Unfortunately, because of what's going on in the legislature, that had to be postponed. So the board has tried to do all of the things, and it has put together options. When you said the board should have had options, you're correct, but they have had options, except they don't know what the revenue component is. And until they know that, then they can't say it's going to be option A, option B, option C, option D. So that's where we stand right now. We've scheduled a meeting for May 6th in the hopes that we will have the answer to the revenue side of the budget, and then we can implement one of those options, or excuse me, May 8th is the meeting, and then after that we would be in a position to know exactly how many people have to be RIFed, and it could be what we would call a surgical RIF, but until then there's simply no way of knowing what programs might go, and that's why the broad RIF occurred here. It's not a preferred way to do it, and I can tell you, this board agonized over it, but there was no other way because of the uncertainty.
Last month and the month before, I recommended that this board raise their budget to the cap, 6.86, and that was disregarded. If you had done that, that number would have been smaller. And that's one of the reasons you're in this spot. You need all 261 of these people. When I meet with them on Monday, I will tell you one thing. I will suggest to those people that once they receive that paper, find another job in a legitimate district, because this isn't one of them. Don't tie yourself up, because you know what? The unfortunate part, or the fortunate part, is I've been around here for 40 years. It's been this way for 40 years. It's never gotten any better. Elected board, appointed board, it's the same thing. It's who's connected, who's going to get appointed. Administration does fine, and teachers get dumped on, and secretaries.
To make you feel better, the part of the state mandate was that we go to the cap. We have to use the bank cap is at max from now. So you did get your wish, but it's not making a change. I know you said it'll help, but that's where we're at. But just to let you know, the bank cap, part of this budget now is at maximum.
At 6.86?
It changed to...
It's at 5.62 because the banked cap was revised.
Down?
Down.
Why?
Because of the health benefits waiver.
5 point what?
6.2.
That's about $1 million more, you'll bet, in this budget. Is that correct?
It's still not approved.
So that should reduce that number also.
Still not approved.
I did a million in my head, Leo. Thank you.
Okay, so we have resolution 51. Can we redo that motion in a second? We did have?
Yes.
So on that motion in second, Trustee Pruden?
Yes.
Trustee Desmond?
Abstain.
Trustee Finnerty?
Yes.
Trustee Gerlach?
Absolutely no.
Trustee LaWanda?
No.
Trustee Mundo?
You know, I don't knock anyone on this dais for voting the way they feel they have to, because this is a very difficult decision, but my personal feeling is instead of cutting, we should be fighting. We should be fighting for our teachers and our staff, and we should be fighting the state. We should be fighting for more state funding. So, you know what? When we go down to that meeting in Trenton Thursday, I hope we're ready. I hope we bring some gloves, because, you know what? At the end of the day, this is the problem, the funding issue. And you know what? Until we fix that, this is going to be more of the same. So, you know what? I'm voting absolutely not no.
Trustee Ryan?
Yes.
Vice President Wilbeck?
Yes.
President Broderick?
Yes.
Resolution passes.
Can I make one statement, please, on the vote, on what was said?
Sure.
Mr. Munoz says it's a funding issue. It's not a funding issue at all. You spent too much money. You spent more than you had. That's why you're in this spot. That is why. When you made a budget last year and the year before, if you worked within that budget, you wouldn't be in this problem.
Hold on. You know what? Let me address that. You know what? I agree with you. I am not suggesting that money wasn't spent, and I'm not suggesting that the people who did it aren't being held responsible. I'm not saying any of that. What I'm suggesting, fact, we are underfunded by $10.2 million every year. You're a math teacher. Over 5 years, it's $51 million. Do you think we'd be in this situation if we had that $51 million? Would we be here right now if we had the $51 million?
If you overspent.
No, we wouldn't.
The way this occurred is you
and the people that are on this board didn't vote to spend that. All right? Because we weren't here when this started.
Okay, excuse me. Excuse me. I want to interrupt. As I've always said, this isn't a city council meeting. We do have some decorum there. You're allowed to ask a question. You're allowed to make a comment. You just don't yell it from the audience. If you'd like to fill out a card and come to the microphone, you're welcome to. But we will not take yelling and screaming out of the audience. I just say that. I would not like to repeat that again, please. Mr. Yenagel, are you done?
I'm done.
Okay. I do have a resolution that needs to be added to the agenda. It's Resolution 52. I'll read it into the record. You do not have it in your packet, Mr. D'Angelo. Whereas the Board of Education conducted a hearing regarding into allegations of bullying regarding student NV and student EB. Whereas said hearing was requested by the parent of the alleged victim of such bullying. Whereas the Board of Education in executive session considered all relevant facts and arguments made by both the parent of the alleged victim and the school administration. Whereas the Board of Education considered the definition of bullying pursuant to NJSA 18A 37-13. Whereas said statute defines bullying as any harassment, intimidation, or bullying which involves conduct where one or more students are victims of another person's aggression, which has not been caused by the victim, which emotionally or physically harms the victims and disrupts the educational process. The bully is further defined as any student who harasses, intimidates, or bullies another person where the behavior is one-sided. Whereas the administration, through the school safety committee, has determined that the alleged acts does not constitute bullying under the relevant New Jersey statute because, one, there was no identified conduct that supports the allegation, and two, there's no reasonable suspicion of any substantial disruption with the orderly operation of the school or rights of any students, including the victim who continued to receive appropriate education. Therefore, be it resolved that the Board of Education concurs with the conclusions of administration, directs the board attorney to provide the requisite notice to the alleged victim's parent as required pursuant to New Jersey Anti-Bullying Bill of Rights. Do I have a motion?
I'll make that motion.
And a second.
I'll second that.
On that motion and second, Trustee Cruden?
Yes.
Trustee Desmond?
Yes.
Trustee Finnerty?
Yes.
Trustee Gerlich?
Aye.
Trustee Lawande?
Yes.
Trustee Munoz?
Yes.
Trustee Ryan?
Yes.
Vice President Wilbeck?
Yes.
President Broderick?
Yes.
Mr. President, that is all I have for this evening, but we do have a list of questions. I will start with Mr. Peter Franco, 127 West 12th Street. And I remind the speakers, we're going to try and stay to 3 minutes.
I just want to ask a quick question related to the ROD grants. You approved the budget. I think you were given permission, I would assume, right, to utilize the ROD grant money for operational expenses, and that was retracted at some point? Okay. I first want to thank you. Obviously, when you guys identified what was going on, you went immediately to the state asking for an audit. So that at the conclusion of this audit, whoever is responsible will finally be held accountable. I know that's on everybody's minds tonight, but you know, in the meantime, I'd like to talk about another issue Mr. Gerlich touched on a few meetings ago and Mr. Munoz just discussed. The fact is this district received $450,000 less from the state than it did last year. And if we go by what is promised in the state's funding formula itself, the Bayonne School District has been shortchanged $20.4 million over the past 2 years. Now, last year, the local tax levy had increased by nearly 3%, and depending on how this board proceeds in May, that percentage could be about 10% in just 2 years. Meaning, while the district isn't getting its fair share from the state, the local taxpayers continue to pay more. And everybody else, you know, we see this, 261 people may be let go. Now, I've come here to speak before on a variety of issues, but most recently I touched upon abatements over the past couple of meetings. And hopefully I was effective in communicating one of the most important parts. While there's three budgets, the school, county, and city, there's one taxpayer, and they continue to draw from. That one taxpayer, like my neighbor Carol or my neighbor Frank, who are on fixed incomes, have watched last year as the school tax was increased by 3%, the city tax was increased by 3%, and the county taxes were raised by 4%. That's 10%. It's only a matter of time before my neighbors will have to sell and move out of their hometown because it's no longer affordable. Meanwhile, it seems like this issue is just political fodder for someone on Avenue C. It's like the pot calling the kettle black when the mayor turns around and scolds this board for a $10 million deficit that wasn't created by you guys. He's pointing the finger, and it gets frustrating. The assemblyman, who is now in a contested race for re-election, wants to blame everything on everybody else. Again, keeping the electorate distracted from his achievements in the assembly, where he raised our gas tax, he attempted to ban our coffee, and he's now attempting to regulate how we grieve. I stand for my neighbors, like Carol and Frank. I understand that you're in a tough position that you found yourself in because of somebody else. Increasing the number of layoffs, increasing classroom sizes, cutting programs, increasing taxes, no one wants to see that. And knowing some of you personally, I know you're devastated about how the state reneged on its agreement to approve the ROD grant money.
Time to wrap up, Mr. Franco.
It's not easy, but it shouldn't be all on this governing body. Instead of pointing fingers, the mayor and the assemblyman could actually do something that would help. They could propose to increase the tax designation on pilots and tax abatements to adequately fund our district. Our neighbor, Jersey City, who receives 8 times the amount in state aid, passed an ordinance that doubles the local funding that goes to its education. When anybody buys a house in this city, they are investing in education. So why should a developer building a $30 million project not have to? Instead of continuing to raise the local levy on taxpayers who have bared the burden for so long, why not put some of the burden on the developers? And now, while we know the governor and the legislature have reneged on its promise to fully fund education, we'd be foolish to assume that a new governor would simply change that. These problems aren't just going to go away. We need a collective approach from all levels of government to address them. Finger-pointing makes for a nice headline in the paper, but finger-pointing doesn't help the residents, it doesn't help the teachers, the students, or the taxpayers.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Mr. Franco.
Thank you, Mr. Franco.
All right, I'm going to ask the speakers, please try and keep your comments down to 3 minutes. I'm going to have to start cutting people, and everybody's going to be mad at Dr. Maida. Next up, Amy Silberman for Blue Heron Lane, Gladstone, New Jersey.
Hi. My name is Amy Silberman. I'm a special ed ESL teacher at Robinson School, and unfortunately I was affected by this cut. I got into teaching for the students. The students mean the world to me, as do they, all of these teachers. And, you know, we're very, very upset. I wanted to find out what is going to happen with the ESL and bilingual program at Robinson School. Because all the teachers have been affected, most of them.
I'll pass this on to either Dr. Degnan or something like that, but as far as I know, the good thing about being an ESL is that it's very state mandated. and as a board, a local board, we really have no choice. In fact, part of the problem that comes about is, just to give you a quick explanation, is when I said to Ms. Jablonski a little while back about this thing starting maybe 10 years ago, for 10 years, taxes were never raised. I shouldn't say that. 6 out of 10 years, it was a zero. Other times, never more than 2% in that range. So we weren't raising any money, all right? But at the same time, the state, and they have the right to do it, mandate certain things, whether it becomes special ed project, ESL, and they don't fund it, they just say, you need to have it. So as far as ESL goes, I mean, it's a very mandatory program, and something that we really, as a local board, couldn't really touch. So as far as what'll happen, and Dr. Degnan, if you'd like to answer this, or somebody.
Yeah, Mr. Broderick, we received the federal Title III and the federal Title III immigrant money, so this is a priority. When the budget is struck, we will definitely take a hard look at an area and prioritize. But okay. It has to be in place, Mr. Broderick.
Because right now, there are most of the bilingual and ESL teachers are on that list
most
at Robinson. Yes.
Most of us, you know, when list came out, just like everyone else saying, well, you need these people, you need those people. But it got to a point where we had no budget. Things were happening quick. We just felt that, and I know, it's, like I said before, it's not well accepted, but the fairest thing to do was to take a step back and look at everything. And we know there's things we can't even deal with, but just to put it on the same table so everyone's in the same area.
Right. I would just hope that every single board member will think about these students that are my life and the lives of all of these teachers behind me. Okay, they're our number one priority, and we should all be thinking about the students.
Our goal was, actually, Mr. Clark mentioned that there was supposed to be a meeting, actually it was supposed to be tomorrow morning, it was canceled, they said early next week.
Right.
The whole goal of that meeting, and I was going to attend, and I will attend whenever it happens, is to go down and to tell these people that we can't provide the thorough and efficient education that we want to or we need to without them, you know, giving us a little leeway. It almost, you know, I hate to say it, but it can almost look like a vendetta against us, the way things are happening. Now, I'm going to say from both sides, yes, mismanagement here in the city happened because of, like I said, whether it was people not wanting to raise taxes and looking, you know, whatever that reason being. And on the other hand, as Mr. Munoz has said, you know, and Mr. Gerlich, that the state certainly isn't doing their fair share to us either. So we're kind of like in a perfect storm, whereas, you know, we didn't raise enough taxes locally. If years ago we just said 2%, 2%, we wouldn't be sitting here tonight in this problem. But nothing, and then people mandating programs without financing it. I can give you an example of it. Our special ed situation. We received $9 million to help us with our special ed situation, which is fine, right. Except that it cost the district over $30 million to run that program. So we're at a loss of $22 million right in that one little category, which we have no control over once again, and wouldn't want control over. You know, these students need everything they deserve. But on the other hand, help us with that, you know, the state should give us a little funding and say, you know, right. We understand it, so you just can't keep adding on, which puts us in a position where we're at.
I understand. I just want you to fight for the kids. I want you to fight as hard as possible for all of these students, all of these gifts from God, okay? Please just work for them and then help the teachers teach them.
Thank you.
Next up is Mr. Jay Minotto, 230 Avenue B. James, 230 Avenue B. Going once, going twice. Okay. Mr. Michael Morris, 123 Avenue C. And I guess next up will be Mr. Anthony D'Amico, 73 West 6th Street will be next.
Good Good evening. Michael Morris, 123 Avenue C, Bayonne. My comments are directed to Mr. Broderick. As president of the Bayonne Board of Education, I found your comments on social media about not addressing these serious budget issues here tonight unacceptable. There should be some reasonable discussion here tonight, but there is none. There should be some reasonable transparency here, and you exhibit none, in my opinion. I believe that you are surreptitiously veiling these issues, and it isn't acceptable to me, and I'm sure to my fellow Bayonne taxpayers. I'm sure that you would agree with me that we have a reasonable right as taxpayers in Bayonne to have this issue addressed reasonably tonight, but there is none again. Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Anthony D'Amico. Sure, we'll let him go first. Yes. We're going to let our student representative up to the microphone, and this way he can go home and do his homework. Just state your name and your school.
Okay. Vic Lazaro, Bayonne High School. Okay. Good evening, Board of Education trustees, Superintendent Dr. McGeehan, Assistant Superintendent Mr. Kopast, Dr. Degman, and Mr. Smith, and all audience that's currently attending in this meeting. I'm just here to give you all a quick insight what's happening within the student government. Next month, the executive board will be having their elections. So basically, there's gonna be new students coming in. I'm gonna be running for my second term. I'm hoping I'm succeeding on getting that second term for my senior year. We've successfully went mostly to every local business in Bayonne for a small donation for our upcoming annual event, which is going to be Powder Puff. And it's going to be on May 31st, 2017. This event will be open to the public, and we're hoping for the continuous support of this event. Thank you.
Anthony D'Amico, 73 West 6th Street.
Anthony D'Amico, 73 West 6th Street. I want to clarify, last meeting I mentioned 41,000 with Mr. Belton going to the high school and the other assistant principal, and you guys jumped in saying it was a total of 800. The 41,000 is what you guys had said was with those two moves for the remainder of this year. So my comment then was you're basically saying $41,000 for this year, while superintendent, thankfully you guys voted down, was in a position to get 26,000 in a merit bonus so that the kids don't have those assistant principals at their graduations moving up and all the stuff at the end of the year. So I just wanted to clarify that. The other thing is, how come we don't hear from Dr. McGeehan on any of these issues, on anything? I mean, her salary is paid by the taxpayers. We deserve to hear from the head, right? Superintendent is in charge of this whole mess. She just sits there, we don't hear anything. We hear from you guys, and it's not even your problem, but she sits there and doesn't have any leadership qualities. Mr. Kopast went and actually spoke against the attorney yesterday, last meeting, and actually showed leadership qualities by addressing the taxpayers. We get nothing from her.
If you had a specific question, we'd address it to...
How are you making $3.5 million appear in this budget since the ROD grant is no longer allowed to be used for operational expenses?
Well, actually, we'd actually hear from our finance department on a matter like that. Everybody would be, maybe Mr. Bolden can answer that.
The capital reserve transfer, as is being referred to as the ROD grants, it's Board of Education money that originally back in 2014 came from the general fund to capital reserve. The state is not letting us move it, as of now, is not letting us move it back into the general fund. It was in the original budget, it was not appropriated. So it was not part of the original budget per se. There's a back end part of the budgeting process, which goes into the other part of our issue with a deficit in the fund balance. So it was not originally going to be appropriated per se in this budget. So we're working on with the legislators on getting us, allowing us to move it back into the general fund to help us with our overall fund balance deficit.
And if they don't let you do that?
What's
If they don't let you do that, where's $3.5 million coming from?
It's not in the budget. We have a balanced budget right now before the state for approval, which does not use that ROD grant or capital reserve funds in the actual budget.
Mm-hmm. The other thing, when you guys say reasons for economy, when you're talking about the layoffs and everything, don't you guys really mean financial incompetence by the previous boards and the superintendents?
We're going to just change our tape right now. We'll get started in a minute. Yeah, next person up is Mr. Joe Wisniewski, 100 East 23rd Street. Joe, just wait on your comments until we get... yeah, that's what I said. We'll call you up. This way we're ready to go.
I don't mind standing here.
Beth, we're good up there? Okay. Okay, Joe, go ahead.
Okay, Joe Wisniewski. Mr. Broderick, I have a question for you. You had mentioned that of the 261 people that are being fired today, you said that two-thirds of them are going to get their jobs back. Is that true?
Approximately, yes.
So you're saying approximately out of 261, 140 of these teachers that are being fired today are going to be back. How could you give them that assurances? No.
Well, first of all, it's not teachers. That's entire staff.
Okay, the staff. How could you give them the assurances that they're going to be back here? Like, how do they know?
As soon as we can develop the programs and know where we need people, that's the effort we're going to try to make to bring them back as soon as possible.
Is that a promise, or you're just guessing?
Well, the promise is that two-thirds will come back. How soon I can bring them back, that I can't say tonight.
Mr. Bartow, I have another question for you. Mr. D'Angelo was up here, and he said he's been involved with the Board of Education for over four decades, and he mentioned the same nonsense goes on at the Board of Education year in and year out. I mean, how come things don't change, and why don't you listen to somebody like a respected man like Mr. D'Angelo and make the changes? If it's going on for four decades, that's over 40 years.
You're correct. Let's see.
How long have you been on the board?
A year and a half.
Year and a half?
Yes, sir. And what I said to Mr. Jablonski, and I'd like, and I'll say it again, is that in that year and a half, we're mostly, since it's been an elected board, they say there's no changes made. But at the same time, like I said before, where has the great spending happened in the last year and a half? We can't say that money shouldn't have been spent 4 years ago on something if we weren't here. 4 years ago, I was walking in the halls up in House 3. But, you know, since we've been here, there's been no major, like I said before, the only major money thing that I spent on was giving the teachers a very fair contract.
Well, listen,
what I hope was fair.
I haven't been to many board meetings, but it seems like the overall consensus is that there's been too much spending going on.
Absolutely.
Now, let me move on to my next thing, since I only have 3 minutes. In one of the local newspapers here, Mayor Davis said that Superintendent Patricia McGeehan and Business Administrator Leo Smith should be held accountable regarding this what's happening here. I want to know if either one of them want to make a comment about this right now, because we're never going to get a comment about it in the newspaper. Now is your time to shine, Patricia McGeehan or Mr. Smith. Would you like to make a comment about the mayor, him saying in the paper, saying that you should be held accountable for this mess? I want one of them to answer the question, please.
If I can interject, though.
I'd rather have one of them, mayor specifically mentioned.
Joe, may I? I just want to inform the entire audience that this is public comment, period, and ordinarily the board doesn't even have to respond to questions. But out of respect for the community and the issues at large, they do. But they're not up here to be taken advantage of with respect to the questions that are asked, nor are the staff to be directed. You can direct comments through the president,
and if he wishes to answer them, he may. He does not necessarily have to do so.
So does that mean Patricia's not going to answer my question?
She doesn't have to answer your question,
well,
and she's
she
not.
To. Let her answer the question.
She's not going to answer the question.
You're not going to answer, Ms. McGinn?
I'm going to tell her, I'm going to direct her not to answer the question.
How about Mr. Smith? I feel you're trying to have called them out in the newspaper. Let them address it, because this is their only time on TV in front of these people. Let them address it. Maybe they don't. If they don't want no comment, then no comment. But at least let them say no comment.
They don't have to do that, sir.
Mr. Smith wants to talk.
Mr. Broderick, if I may.
Thank you.
If I may.
I'm just going by what the mayor said.
Absolutely. And he's a very fine man. He's a former student here at Bayonne High School.
Okay,
Okay. We are working right now with the auditors. Unfortunately, what happened, we had an accountant in place that we depended on. We counted on him to make the books work. For years, he was on top of his game. I'm not mentioning any names or anything, okay? He let us down.
He let us down tremendously. The mayor, you're saying?
No, I'm saying the former accountant.
Okay.
Okay?
Now who hired
him? I am not an accountant by trade.
Who hired
Dr.
the McGeehan, accountant?
You wanted me to make a statement.
I'm sorry.
If you want me to make a statement,
I'm
going to make a statement. I'm going to give you the facts as they are. Okay?
Yes.
Dr. McGeehan is not an accountant by trade. Neither am I. We depend on good people to do the right thing. We had a former accountant who let us down tremendously. When we found out via the CAFRA report, November 20th of 2016, when the auditors came in and they told me, it was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, I went right across the hall to Dr. McGeehan and we alerted this board. Since that time, we have been working day and night to try to correct the problem. In regards to the ROD grants is our money, ladies and gentlemen. The state is not allowing us to tap into it. That money was neither borrowed, it was not bonded for, and it was not a stipulation of a grant. We took it from our left pocket and put it in our right pocket. We want to utilize that money now, but the state is not letting us utilize it. So maybe some of our elected officials, okay, who we are going to meet with, can help us in that vein. Instead of putting out press releases and saying that Dr. McGeehan, who's given her life's blood to this district, okay, is to be held accountable for the short-sightedness of an accountant that we had who has since moved on to a different district.
Thank you. That's where
we are right now. We're working with the auditors. When we find out where the problems came from, if there are problems, we will be transparent and we will bring them to this board.
Thank you very much. What I wanted to also say, the mayor also said in the newspaper that the board is not being transparent.
At this time, we are way over.
Wait a minute,
now,
I didn't get a chance to talk. Everybody else talked. Give me another minute.
One minute.
I just have two questions and I'll be on my way.
I shut the timer off every time somebody was answering you. I'm sorry, you're way over three.
But I didn't talk. It was everybody else that did the talking.
You asked them.
Dr. Mater turned the clock off when someone else spoke.
So I can't finish.
Well, there was
a lot of questions you asked. I think you got some of them answered. So I'm going to move on to Ms. Jody Marker, 81 East 23rd Street. It's Jody Markey. 81 East 23rd.
Markey, not Marker.
I'm sorry,
Mark. Not a problem.
K-E-Y.
Good evening. I think we can all agree that everything that's being discussed tonight is an adult problem. It's an adult issue created by adults, and it should be dealt with by adults. But I think the only transparent thing happening tonight is putting all of the ownership on the children. We're making the children deal with the outcome of this crisis. Whether you want to believe it or not, whether you want to give state and federal mandates as the answer to every question that's being answered, it's ludicrous. That teacher asked a specific question about what is going to happen to the students, not the teachers. She wasn't speaking for herself. She was just fired, for lack of a better term. And she didn't come up here to talk about herself. She asked a question about her students, and it wasn't answered.
Yes, sir.
She was given a response about the federal funding, the state funding, the program. But in reality, there's a group of children who are going to go into a classroom, maybe not tomorrow, and not have their teachers there. And that's unacceptable. And everyone who voted to make that happen needs to know that it's unacceptable. I am the parent of three children in Lincoln Community School, that teeny tiny little school on the east side that some people forget about. But we're there, and we're fierce. 18 people from that little building were affected tonight. 18! 18! When those children, and you all claim to care about the children, walk into school when this mandate goes into effect, who's going to be there to explain why this teacher's not there? Why this custodian who greets them at the gate every morning or helps them into school? Or the nurse or the secretary? All of those people who make up a school building. You're plucking them out one by one like a Jenga board. One by one. Let's take an aide. Let's take a custodian. Let's take the secretary. And you're stacking them up. Maybe you're putting them somewhere else. Maybe you're sending them to other districts. What happens when that building gets unstable? You've plucked everybody out of it. It's going to crumble. And who's going to pay?
The kids.
A teacher who just lost her job came up here to continue to fight for her kids. I'm a parent. I'm here fighting for my kids and everybody else's. It's not their fault. And you're not coming out and saying, we're going to blame the kids. Of course, you would never do that. But you're dancing around every question. You haven't moved out of your chair, but you're a very good dancer. And I don't mean any disrespect, but concrete answers that are relevant to the students of this city. How are we going to build children who can go on to colleges and careers if we keep taking out their support system? These people in these buildings are their support system, no matter what their capacity is in that building, whether they clean the floors or they sign the checks. And you're plucking them out one by one. When does it stop? Those are my children. Those are my three children. And they're going to walk into a building minus 18 adults that they have learned over the past 3 years to count on, to go to turn to get the education that they are owed. Give it back to them.
Ms. Markey, thank you for your comments. Next up, Justine Bazio, 42 East 22nd. Justine, okay. Michelle Jablonski. This is on the open portion of the meeting. She's allowed to ask a question.
Dr. Maeda and Mr. Broderick, I wanted to speak on something, a topic with Mr. Nunziel. So would it be possible for Mr. Nunziel to speak first?
He did have a card, so sure. Why
yes.
don't...
Because I'm just going to follow up his comment.
Gotcha. So Charles Nunziel, 256 Harrison Avenue. Why don't we leave them there, and I'll make sure we get copies to all the trustees, unless you already did that. Okay. I didn't start you, but you better hurry.
The first thing I'd like to say to the audience, I apologize for detracting from the gravity of the discussion today, but I'm sure everybody sitting here very much appreciates what Dr. Resitar and Mrs. Jablonski and the parents just spoke about. And we really appreciate that.
Sorry.
So I just want to make sure. I'm a guidance counselor at Bayonne High School. Some of you on the stage know me and some don't. I'm just bringing attention to an issue that's affecting 541 students in the high school. And again, I'm here as a counselor. I like to think of myself as a student advocate for 180 days, not for one day when they give us a donut and they say, thank you very much. I'm here for the 540 students. So I hope you bear with me. Okay, the first thing is, I've given the people on the stage a handout. This first yellow paper says graduation requirements. Right now, this is in every student's folder in the high school. And one of the requirements under science says physical science. Okay, that's the big word, physical science. Okay, these other papers, if your parents have probably seen these are the schedule forms that we give to 3,000 students during the year. So this would be sophomores, this would be juniors, and this would be seniors. Now, because there's a lot of responsibility with this, the guidance counselors start this process like in February. Okay, February. And on the top of these papers, it says revised March 31st. March 31st. And again, on each of the papers, it'll say science. And if you look at code 565, you'll see the words physical science. So obviously, every counselor at the high school said to the students, physical science is available. Now, I'm not going to get into the reasons why we recommend it because that would just distract us, but it does say physical science, okay? Then, this other paper came out, and on the top of it says graduation requirements revised April 2017, okay? And underneath science, it says, now believe this, it says physical science is not a science. Okay, now this is 2 years after someone said anatomy and physiology is not a science. Ecology and marine science is not a science. Okay, science seminar is not a science. So now, I'm bringing to the attention of the Board of Education because today I try to get an answer like who determines that physical science no longer counts. Now these papers here is a list of 541 students who took physical science. Now many of you in the audience probably know you need 3 years of science to graduate. Now, these students don't have 3 years of science. So if I'm a senior and I barely got through my sciences based on my counselor helping me, my teachers helping me, my directors helping me, I took biology, I took physical science, I took environmental science because that met my needs. Now, someone is telling us we have to give these students chemistry. Now, if they fail chemistry as a senior, they don't graduate.
Okay, Mr. Nunziel, we're over 3 minutes, so I'm going to ask Mr. Blonsky to come up, and hopefully there's a question all of this.
My question to Mr. Broderick is, when you review this, Mr. Broderick, do you think this is fair?
Mr. Blonsky, do you want to come up and continue? And still waiting for the question, other than is it fair?
Okay, so to get to the bottom of this, I teach physical science. And as of right now, the way this document reads, The class of 2017 must take biology and chemistry and physics or environmental science to graduate. It reads class of 2017 and on. It was revised this month. There are students in Bayonne High School who took physical science as one of their 3 years of required science. I have over 100 students this year in my classes taking physical science, and they are working very hard. And now many of them are sophomores, some of them are juniors, and even a few of them are seniors. If this is the Board of Ed approved document for class of 2017 and on, there are students that will not graduate this year based on this document. So my question is this a valid document?
The requirement from Michael Hines, who's the director of science for the state of New Jersey, is biology, chemistry, physics, and or environmental science. That's what's recommended. For a while, yes, we did do physical science. It's not a requirement. When we got the email from Michael Hines, we met with the director of science, the director of student personnel services, and the principal of the high school. We don't want to endorse a diploma that's not a graduation requirement. It's a graduation requirement, so, not physical science. Concern is going to be with those juniors, correct?
And what about the sophomores? Sophomores, you know, we need to make informed decisions. You can't, you know, you're changing the rules in the middle of the game. You know, this happened last year. I happened to be the marine science teacher. And that used to be the third year of graduation requirements. And at about this same time last year, it was decided that marine science was no longer going to be acceptable as the third year graduation requirement. I had some seniors in my marine science class that needed that class as their third year of science in order to graduate in 2 months. I had to go and fight for those students, and here I am again. I think God assigns me these courses just to fight for students. We cannot change the rules of the game in the middle of the game. Sophomores taking physical science believe and were told, and it was written on a graduation document, that would count as their graduation requirement, 3 years. And now they're in the middle of the game and finishing this class. If they see this document, you tell me what students I'm going to get to do any work for the rest of this year. Mrs. Jablonski, this class counts for nothing. It's a big joke.
The graduation requirement is biology, chemistry, environmental science, and or physics. We're made aware of it. We have to do it. Mr. Baccarella signs the diploma. You can use the physical science as a bridge for those students. You can use the physical science as a bridge for those students. You have to take algebra, geometry, algebra 2. Some go on to take other classes.
Ms.
Jablonski, I agree with you. I was a former science teacher. I like marine science. I agree there should be other courses, astronomy. But I'm just going by what Michael Hines said.
I'm not saying anything about the courses. I'm just saying these students are signing up for the course being told that it counts as their three-year graduation requirement. And in the middle of the game, while they're in the course, they're now going to be told that this doesn't count. So I have students that can't stand science and are working very hard in my class. And now they have to turn around as juniors and take chemistry, and as seniors take physics or environmental science. And if they don't pass both those classes, they will not graduate in 4 years. Some of these students are very much at risk. and we are now putting that requirement on them, pushing a senior year course as a graduation requirement, when they could have made an informed decision and just bit the bullet and taken chemistry as sophomores.
Is there no grandfathering into any of these courses?
I do not believe there is. I can talk to Mr. Director of Science, and we can get another email. It's not a problem, and we could bring it up in a workshop on May 8th. Absolutely not a problem.
I can only promise.
But I do know that's what the email stated, Mr. Broderick, and I just don't want to endorse a diploma that a graduation requirement is not being met. If you want to look into grandfather, I will absolutely do that.
Well, last year, some marine science students were grandfathered.
I promise I'll take a look at
that. Thank you. Next
thank
up
you for bringing it up.
Is Alicia Lazinski. 115 Avenue C.
Good evening, Alicia Lashanzi, Henry Harris, PTA president. Sorry, I was distracted. Just texted my son to see if he took physical science. This evening, I spoke at the last meeting. This evening, I've heard many what-ifs thrown around. But what I'd like to discuss is the reality before me. Today I received a phone call from a Hudson County PTA representative, and we speak often. They help us out on the local level. She's aware of the deficit and the fiasco that we're facing here in Bayonne. In fact, so is the state level PTA. They're all pretty much, I'll use the word, amazed at the fiasco that we face. This is an educational system here in Bayonne that I used to be proud of. And unfortunately now, it's turning into a laughingstock. Every time we meet, the deficit seems to grow higher and higher. As a parent of three children here in Bayonne, I spoke as a PTA president, as a concerned parent, for friends who are losing jobs, and more importantly, for our students and my own children. We lost losing our vice principal, Mr. Brian Belton, who is key to our school. When I questioned where was the accountability, I was told that an audit will reveal that. I heard those same words spoken again this evening. Tonight we learned that our children have been and will continue to be affected with more cuts. And we don't know what the future holds. More staff to be cut, more programs, more sports. We don't know how we're going to get out of this. There are many what-ifs thrown around, but the problem is we have a problem. An audit isn't necessary to tell me that somebody wasn't watching the books and doing their jobs. Someone wasn't watching their spending and doing their jobs. As I walked in tonight, I came a little late, I apologize. I was listening to a vote about giving the superintendent a $26,000 merit bonus. I'm appalled at that. We're in a fiasco crisis, and you're looking at a bonus? PTA has a budget. We are nine women on the board. I have a treasurer who is diligent and on my back. Alicia, we don't have the money for that. We can't spend that. Every month, she provides us with a treasury report. Every month, I look at the checkbook. I know what we have. I know what we can spend. Every year, at the beginning of the year, we know what's allotted and what we're allowed. Not that I'm comparing volunteers to your level, but you get the gist of my comparison. And I am not an accountant by trade. I do know how to watch the numbers. So, this board was elected by the people of Bayonne. Since the new board has taken seat, have you done anything to help the people, the taxpayers, or teachers in respect to the surmounting deficit getting worse? Every time we meet, it increases. Every time, the Henry Harris PTA, parents, faculty, people sitting in this room, and people in Bayonne want to know, are you with the people, or are you with Dr. McGeehan and Mr. Smith, who put us in this predicament?
Thank you.
Are you able to respond?
To
the question?
I've said before that this is a problem that's been created over many years. We're here now. once again, I can tell you, you said it just keeps getting worse, but it didn't get worse over the last year and a half, let's say. It's probably gotten better, or it would have been worse, and we're working very hard at fixing it. Now, if you get a bad situation, that's what you got to deal with, and that's what we have right now is a bad situation. We're doing everything we think is possible. We're making the cuts that, unfortunately, we have to do. We're raising taxes, which is being state mandated. It's not even us. It's the state says you have to use every penny of that bank cap. We're just doing what needs to be done to get this fixed. Now, everybody would like it to be in a hurry. It can't be in a hurry. We have to wait for an audit to find out who was the problem or where the problem came from. It's going on right now, but I can't tell the auditor, I want to know tomorrow. They're going to tell us, these are people from the state. It's not people that we control. So everything takes a little bit of time. Is it a bad situation? Absolutely. Will it get better? Absolutely. But not without, like I said before, some pain and effort by everybody. I wish I had a better answer for you. But
I do too, because my concern is if it's not recognized and accountability isn't given.
Well, I think it is being recognized. I think that's why we're sitting here now. And we really recognize that there's a problem, and we really recognize that we have to fix it.
Okay, thank you for your comments. Next up is Mr. Joe Wyatt.
You want my address?
Yes, please.
Joe Wyatt, 301 Maple Avenue, apartment 261, North Plainfield, New Jersey, 07060. There's a movie called Network, in which one of the prime characters, in a fit of pique, raises the window and shouts out to the world, "I'm mad as hell, and I'm not going to take it anymore." We are like that character, except with one great difference. We're mad as hell, but we have to take it. I recently ran into a gentleman who was on a board member in another district, and I was complaining about all the problems we were having. And he said, "Oh, well, would you like to know how it all works?" And I've been asking that question for 7 years, but nobody will tell me. It's all buried in administrative statutes. And I found out to my chagrin that by design, I am powerless and you are powerless. The whole thing is designed to give absolute power to the superintendent of schools. That's insanity. If you give absolute power to someone, then as Lord Acton says, absolute power corrupts, power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. To make it worse, you give someone absolute power that has no accountability. That's a prescription for disaster. You think this is a mess? Wait until you have to pick a new superintendent. This is the key to solving all your problems. It's orders of magnitude harder. And in science, we talk about multiplication like two or three times as hard, and we also talk about orders of magnitude, which means 10, 100, 1,000 times more harder. You are really going to have to bite the bullet if you want to fix this problem. Otherwise, you're going to go right down the tube. It's going to happen exactly the same thing as other people have been saying. It's been happening for 40 years. So I'm going to come back because the stupid three-minute rule, I mean, I just don't get it. It's against everything that we stand for as a country, that we should have expression. You have no information that comes to you except through the superintendent. That's insane, folks. You have to start listening to other points of view. I do not want you to agree with me. I want you to listen and put that together with everything. I wasn't elected to the board. You were. But you have an obligation to listen to other people and put that all in the mix and do the best job you can. And as long as I'm heard and acknowledged, I'm happy with that. So I'm going to come back, and if I have to come back 3 minutes until hell freezes over, I'm going to go through this. What we need to do is, what is our purpose to be here? What's the problem? How do we fix it? And the way you fix it is you ask very pointed questions to the next person who's going to be the superintendent. And I will give you that list of that questions. If you don't ask those questions, it's on you. Okay, if you ask those questions and you make the wrong decision, that's on you. Hopefully, you'll ask the right questions, you'll get the right person, you'll get somebody who will actually help us out.
Next up is Ms. Nefra Kokamis, 101 Avenue F.
Sorry, I'm a little nervous. I can't get through all that I prepared because of the three-minute limitation. I can't get through all that I prepared because of the three-minute limitation, so I'll do my best to get straight to the point, and that is that I'm here for my children. They are born and raised in Bayonne. They love going to school. They love their community, their neighborhood, their teachers. So with that being said, I ask you, how do you imagine Bayonne's future without a strong educational foundation for our children? Who will look to Bayonne as a place to live, as a place to work, as a desirable community where they would like to settle? Which families, which teachers? We can just take a look at psychographic statistics, and it shows that the type of neighborhood that education create that's created through education. And that should be taken into consideration with all development going on right now. History shows us the benefits of knowledge, and I imagine that you all know that because you're where you're sitting at the moment. So, to the end of my prepared message, I implore you, please take another look, see if there's anything else that can be done for our children's sake, for the sake of our city, for the sake of our country, and most importantly, for the sake of education. Education is not a privilege, it's our right.
Next up is Carol Vassiotis, 11 Pavonia Court.
Good evening. I just have one question. Should tomorrow come and you have 261 teachers that don't show up for work tomorrow, what's the policy and protocols that are in place to help have coverage for all these teachers that are not there?
I guess it'd be the same as on any other day.
What is that policy? Do you have staff to cover 261 teachers?
We'd do our best to get, the subs or whatever we would need.
Okay. So then what will happen in September?
September?
Hypothetically speaking.
Can I answer a question?
Sure.
As of right now, in September, as bad as people are thinking this is going to be, in all at least the core classes, the enrollment, the seat numbers, is not going to be more than approximately 28 people per class. And that's, I know it's gone up, but it's still not exactly what we'd call, dramatic. I have people come up and say to me, what are you going to have, 40 people in a row? No, it's not going to be anything like that.
My kid's class has 26 now.
Excuse me? Well, the numbers that we were given by the people at central office, I asked this just the other day, was how many people are going to be in a class? We need to know this so we know just how bad things are going to be, how many people can we not let go. And they assured me, and Dr. Degnan, I'm sure he could tell us now, is that the numbers will be no more than, say, 28, that kind of number. So,
mathematically, it doesn't work out.
I assure you that your child's not coming next year and sitting in a room with 40 people. It's nothing like that.
But if we're losing 261 teachers, how does the mathematics figure out to 28
kids
in a classroom?
Well, you're saying 261 teachers, and it's not 261 teachers. It's 261 staff members being riffed at the moment.
Okay.
But by the time September comes, that's September 1st, two-thirds of those people will be back in place, along with every non-tenured teacher.
But worst-case scenario, doesn't happen...
Well, that's like Mr. Wood said... Worst case, there's always a worst case scenario.
But we have to prepare for the worst case scenario, correct? You can't have students walking into a classroom with no teacher.
Well,
or 40 kids in a classroom.
That's certainly not our goal. And I don't think it's something we could allow.
I don't think it's anyone's goal. But we need to have something in place should that happen. We can't wait until the 11th hour.
Why do you
think we've done now.
I ask why you think that would happen?
Because 261 people just got essentially fired.
Well,
right? Or did I miss something?
But I also said that before, and as quickly as you can bring back, over 2/3 of those people will be returned.
But that's not guaranteed. What's guaranteed is the 261 names that are up on that board.
But I can also guarantee that that number of people will return.
You can guarantee that?
To my best.
Okay. And I just have a statement to all of the people that received those letters today. Please know that your hard work and dedication does not go unnoticed from parents. Thank you.
Our final speaker this evening is Mr. D'Angelo.
Pardon me?
If you're up again?
No.
You're done? Mr. President, that is all I have for this evening.
Thank you.
Is there a motion to adjourn? Oh, I'm sorry, wait.
On? Thank you. Thank you very much. Yes, I would like to make a statement. I've listened to all. Every one of those teachers that were given the notice, or will be given the notice tomorrow, actually, I recommended them for their positions. Every administrator that was cut, 9 administrators over the past few months, I fought for them to be in their positions through the years to cover the security of the building, to cover evaluations, for all the reasons why we need to have more help in a building that's 700, that's 500. That was part of my mission, to make sure that we would give our students the best education. This is extremely upsetting to me. Please believe me, this is not easy. We are underfunded. You may not like to hear those words, but we are. I did something as silly as calling Governor Christie and asking him for an appointment. I have made 3 phone calls to him, followed by 3 emails, followed by begging that he hear our case. He is the one that will make the decision on where the funding goes. It's there, folks. It's there for Bayonne. And Bayonne has not been taken care of for year after year after year. Mr. Smith and I went to the assembly presentation and we begged, why not Bayonne? Why not Bayonne? Why don't Bayonne kids count? Then we went to the senatorial presentation that was in Newark. And we did the same thing. And at that meeting, Mayor Fulop was there asking for help for Jersey City. Mayor Baraka from Newark was there asking for help for the Newark students. And Mr. Smith and I were alone asking for help for the Bayonne students. We have spoken to our legislators numerous, numerous times. We had asked for meetings. We're trying to get a meeting. Actually, it was set up with the new commissioner for help. All these things, I have been in education for 48 and a half years. Do you think this is something that I would like to end in my tenure here as a superintendent, a teacher, an educator? Absolutely not. But with the funding not being had in this district for all these years, for special education, we'd be told that we have to do this, and we should do it. $9 million, that's all we got. But it cost us $33 million. Amy, the ESL bilingual program, what we had to do there with the growth of the children that are there, and they need it. The state told us to do it. We had to hire so many teachers this past year, and we were told we had to do it, but nobody helped us with any money. The state told us we had to do world language. We started world language. They didn't give us any money for that. They told us we had to cut the size back from pre-K, from 21 to 18. They didn't give us any money for that. But there are areas close to our border, 1 inch away from Woodrow Wilson School. What is the difference from that school district for those children and for the children of Bayonne? Our children should count. And I'm starting something very soon, which is an SOS, Save Bayonne. And every administrator knows what that is all about. We are starting a social media campaign to bring light here. Several years ago, we filled this room just with all of you. We sent 10,000 letters down to Trenton to ask for help for Bayonne. We had every legislator here in this room helping us locally. What did we get, folks? Nothing. So this is not new. For some reason, Bayonne is not even on the map. I mean, in the state of New Jersey. Everybody forgets about Bayonne. All these other districts are taken care of. In Hudson County, I sit at round table meetings and I hear from the superintendents what they have done and how much money they have and what their support services are. And when I tell them that we have school buildings with an administrator of 700 prior to us getting the help of the vice principals, they're in awe. They're in awe. How do you do it? I said, because we have dedicated teachers that love their students. We have dedicated administrators that love their students. And I love our students. And I'm very concerned about all of you. Because first of all, none of you would be sitting in this room unless I recommended you for your positions. So you have to believe that this wasn't done frivolously. This was done because we need you, because I was told that we had the funding. And I, as the CEO of this school district, with over 1,400 employees and 9,700 children to watch, which is not an easy job, I must depend on what is on my left and my left, what is on my right that's sitting over there. And they, in turn, depend on the people that work for them. I am not an accountant. I cannot watch books. And I'm sure the city leader does not watch the books of what his accountant does every single day. It's impossible. But when I do projects and I do things, I ask the people that work for us because I trust them. You can't be a leader without trusting the people that work for you. We were disappointed by what happened. We did not know. And I have to tell you, if any of you know me well enough, you would know that if I know something, I'm going to take care of it and fix it. And it's a shame that I had to plead that I had ignorance, but I was told that things were okay. And when somebody tells you it's okay, you believe it's okay. Or else, how can you even go to work every day if you don't trust your employees? So please be patient. We will get many of you back. I firmly believed that we should not have done this blanket thing that was done here. So the Board of Education does not always listen to the superintendent, so that you will know that. I make suggestions. The Board of Education follows what they want to do. They make the policies. They do the resolutions. And they have that authority to do that. So this is not a dictator that decides what happens here. Every time I excuse me, I have bad allergies. Every time I make a recommendation, they have to approve it. It stands there. I do not have the final say on all of the things that happen in this district. So sometimes people are saying that, but that's not true. So I want to get all of you back. I have 2 months left. I will fight every day for you. I'm going to Trenton. Hopefully, I've spoken to our legislators. I will call Governor Christie every single day. We will go forward with our social media to promote what our needs are. But folks, we need your help too. It's nice for you to sit there and come out tonight, but we also need you to fight for yourselves and fight for this district. It's not alone what these gentlemen and ladies can do on my right and what people that work for the district can do on my left. It's a united effort. If you let the people know in Trenton, if you join with us in this campaign, we will be successful. But just remember, we send 10,000 letters of children and people that wrote, and nobody answered us. There are people that came here that spoke, but nobody answered us from the big legislation that we have in the state of New Jersey. So this did not just start. This has been growing and growing and growing, and we were kind of not aware of the depth of it. Because as soon as I found out, we have now budget meetings that I sit at all the time now. So I want everyone to know that, to please understand that we are working as hard as we can, and we will work hard. I have 60 days left in this school district, and I'll work hard because remember why you're all standing here. It's because I recommended you, and I made very good recommendations, and I'm very proud of each and every one of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. McGinn.
The motion to adjourn. Mr. Broderick, I am adjourning the meeting. Okay, there is a motion to adjourn.
You can make a motion, yeah.
By Trustee Luande. Is there a second?
I'll fill out a card.
Folks, we gave you rules to fill out a card. I said it a number of times tonight. You can ask the board, but I'm being told, am I adjourning the meeting?
I have just one quick question.
Will you please?
One question, last okay. Person.
Last month, Kieran White, 80 West 32nd Street. Last month, I believe there was some sort of resolution signed with this board and the superintendent, Dr. McGeehan, where she wouldn't be sued or she wouldn't sue the board upon her exiting this her employment with the district. And I was just wondering if the same type of resolution was signed with the outgoing attorney. Was anything signed with that attorney? Because against the advice of your counsel here, both of you made statements at a public meeting, and you're throwing that guy under the bus. And I'm just wondering if the audit uncovers actual misappropriations of monies by you guys, could he sue this board for defamation and libel?
All right. Thank you.
Well, thank you. So I have a motion to adjourn by Trustee Luande. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Second by President Broderick. On a motion and a second to adjourn the public meeting, Trustee Cruden.
Yes.
Trustee Desmond.
Yes.
Trustee Finnerty.
Yes.
Trustee Garrelly.
Aye.
Trustee Luande.
Yes.
Trustee Munoz. Trustee Ryan.
Yes.
Vice President Wilbeck.
Yes.
President Broderick. It
yes.
is 10:10 p.m.